Hey, this is Dave DeCamp from AntiWar.com, and this is Anti-War News for Monday, September 19th, 2022. Hope everybody had a good weekend. The first story at the top of AntiWar.com. President Biden has again, for the fourth time of his presidency, said that the U.S. would defend Taiwan in the event of a Chinese invasion, despite the longstanding U.S. policy of strategic ambiguity. This was in a 60 Minutes interview that aired on Sunday when Biden was asked if U.S. forces would defend Taiwan. He replied, quote, yes, if in fact there was an unprecedented attack, end quote. So the host, Scott Pelley, he followed up by asking, you know, to make sure that unlike Ukraine, the U.S. would defend Taiwan, would intervene militarily to fight China. And President Biden replied, yes. So I have the clip here. We could watch it so you could hear it for yourself. Let's take a listen.
What should Chinese President Xi know about your commitment to Taiwan?
We agree with what we signed on to a long time ago, and that there's a one China policy, and Taiwan makes their own judgments about their independence. We are not moving. We're not encouraging them being independent. We're not let. That's their decision.
But would U.S. forces defend the island?
Yes, if in fact there was an unprecedented attack.
After our interview, a White House official told us U.S. policy has not changed. Officially, the U.S. will not say whether American forces would defend Taiwan. But the commander-in-chief had a view of his own.
So unlike Ukraine, to be clear, sir, U.S. forces, U.S. men and women would defend Taiwan in the event of a Chinese invasion.
Yes.
So there you have it. I mean, you know, Biden is definitely prone to his gaffes, but I don't think we could chalk this one up to a gaffe. As you heard in that clip, the White House has sort of walked it back by saying that U.S. policy hasn't changed. And this is the fourth time that they've walked back this Biden saying this, that the U.S. would defend Taiwan. A White House spokesperson said, quote, the president has said this before, including in Tokyo earlier this year. He also made clear then that our Taiwan policy hasn't changed. That remains true, end quote. So under the policy of strategic ambiguity, the U.S. is not supposed to say one way or the other if it would intervene to defend Taiwan if China attacks. Back in 2001, this is something I linked to in this article, Joe Biden, when he was a senator, he criticized President George W. Bush for suggesting that the U.S. would defend Taiwan, then later walking it back. In an op-ed for the Washington Post, President Biden, then Senator Biden, wrote that words matter and that it hurt, and that Bush hurt the credibility of the U.S. by making such comments due to inattention to detail. So Biden rightly pointed out in this 2001 op-ed that the U.S. has not been obligated to defend Taiwan since it terminated the 1954 Mutual Defense Treaty with Taiwan, which was signed by President Eisenhower and ratified by the Senate. The treaty was terminated after the U.S. formalized diplomatic relations with Beijing in 1979. So for a while there, the U.S. was a treaty ally of Taiwan, but as part of opening up with Beijing, the U.S. adopted the one China policy, recognizing that there is one China and Taiwan is part of that China, and agreed that Beijing is the government of China. So under that policy, you can't be obligated to defend an island that you don't even consider to be a country. But Biden, as you heard in the clip, he also claimed that the U.S. is still committed to this one China policy. But from Beijing's perspective, the frequent U.S. delegations to Taiwan and other U.S. support for the island are a sign that Washington is moving away from the one China policy. And that's, you know, we saw Nancy Pelosi go there, which really sparked the largest ever Chinese military drills around the island. There's been more and more. And Congress is also working on a piece of legislation that would radically change U.S. policy toward Taiwan. This is what I went over a lot last week. The Taiwan Policy Act would give Taiwan $6.5 billion in military aid. It would give the island the benefit of being a major non-NATO ally, expedite arms sales to Taiwan, and require sanctions in the event of Chinese aggression. So where this bill stands now, it was approved by the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. The next step is a vote on the Senate floor. Not sure exactly when that's supposed to happen or when it might happen. But this is just more, I mean, what Biden is saying in this clip is that the U.S. would go to war with China if it attacks Taiwan, which implies that he's willing to go to nuclear war over Taiwan, or willing to risk nuclear war over Taiwan. And again, this is the message he's sending to China, whether or not official U.S. policy hasn't changed. Biden is making clear that it's his policy. I think a lot of people will say that, you know, since he seems so out of it all the time, that you can't really say he's speaking, what he says is really speaking for the U.S., but he's definitely speaking for himself, at least. All right, the next one here, the U.S. So this is goodish news here. The U.S. is hesitant to provide Ukraine with longer-range missiles. The Biden administration is reluctant to give Ukraine these longer-range missiles that they have been asking for, as Russia has warned providing such arms would make the U.S. a party to the conflict. Ukraine has asked the U.S. for Army tactical missile systems, which have a range, they are a missile that have a range of about 190 miles, which is much farther than anything the U.S. has given Ukraine up to this point. The HIMARS rocket launch systems that the U.S. has sent Ukraine are currently equipped with missiles that can hit targets up to 50 miles away. So the New York Times reported on Saturday that Biden is resisting Ukraine's calls to send the arms. The report cited senior aides to Biden, who said that the president was told by the Pentagon that the benefits of sending Ukraine these missiles would be minimal. So that led him to conclude it was not worth the risk of provoking Moscow. The Russian Foreign Ministry said last week that if the U.S. did send these longer range missiles, it would cross a red line and make the U.S. a direct party to the conflict. And in that scenario, Russia would be forced to respond. So the U.S. appears, at least for now, to have heeded the Russian warning. NBC News reported that senior Pentagon officials are opposed to giving Ukraine these longer-range missiles, and that the administration has held off on the request over fears that it could provoke a dangerous response from Moscow. Military officials told NBC that the U.S. was afraid these missiles could be used to target Russian territory and provoke a wider war. So it's possible that the U.S. could send these longer-range missiles in the future, as the Biden administration has shown its willingness to escalate its involvement as the war has gone on. It's escalated its role in the war. And what's interesting here is that U.S. officials told the New York Times that they recognize that Putin would have likely pushed back if they had given Ukraine the support that it receives today at the outset of the war, meaning that all the weapons that they're giving them, the intelligence sharing, if that was happening, if that started right after Putin invaded, then he likely would have responded then. A U.S. official told reporters on Friday that sending these longer range missiles is not on the table at this time, but added that the battlefield dynamics can change, and as Ukraine's needs evolve, the type of assistance can evolve. So they're leaving the door open to send these missiles. All right, the next one here, Russian President Vladimir Putin. He warned on Friday that Russia could escalate in Ukraine in response to terrorist attacks against civilian infrastructure inside Russian territory. So Putin has framed his invasion, has framed the war as a special military operation that could be upgraded into a full-scale war. His government recently rejected calls to mobilize for war, which would involve implementing a nationwide draft, but they've been rejecting those calls, which have been growing since Ukraine's Kharkiv offensive. But Putin has signaled that there could be an escalation. He said at a press conference on Friday, quote, "Indeed, we were quite restrained in our response, but that will not last forever. Recently, Russian armed forces delivered a couple of sensitive blows in that area," end quote. So what he's talking about there is that Russian strikes on Ukrainian power infrastructure that came after the Kharkiv counteroffensive, when Ukraine gained a decent amount of territory. And he said, if the situation continues, talking about these attacks inside Russia and other Ukrainian offensives, that their response would be more impactful, as he put it. So Russia has not we haven't seen large-scale airstrikes on civilian infrastructure from Russia, like meant to cripple the power infrastructure and transportation and things like that, stuff that the U.S. has done in countless wars in Syria and Iraq, going back to World War II, Vietnam. But Putin accused, in this press conference, he accused Ukraine of attempting to attack nuclear power plants inside Russia. And I linked to one of our viewpoints we have today from Ray McGovern about this accusation, because he said it was not mentioned in the Western media coverage of Putin's press conference, because it's a pretty significant accusation, Putin, to say that Ukraine has tried to attack Russian nuclear power plants inside Russia. So that's a good analysis about the situation from Ray, about this very dangerous situation that we're in. But, you know, we don't know if Putin's accusation is true, but the fact that he's making it is significant. The Russian-controlled Zaporizhia nuclear power plant inside Ukraine has been the site of frequent shelling, but Putin's comments were the first time that Russia accused Ukrainian forces of attacking a nuclear plant in Russian territory. Throughout the war, there have been a series of attacks inside Russia near the Ukrainian border, including operations against oil facilities. I linked to there was a drone attack on a few oil facilities inside Russia back in June. And just on Saturday, Ukrainian shelling was reported in Russia's Belgorod region, which is on the border near Kharkiv. And there was shelling reported there during the counteroffensive. Local authorities said that one person was killed and two were wounded in the shelling on Saturday. So that's just an example of how the war can escalate, especially if Ukraine uses U.S.-provided weapons to attack Russia. And the U.S. gave a lot of weapons to Ukraine, and they said they got assurances that they wouldn't be used against Russian territory. But we will, who knows? It could always happen. I just have to take a moment to mention our great sponsor, How the West Brought War to Ukraine, which is a book by Benjamin Abloh about U.S. and NATO provocations toward Russia after the Cold War. And it's really separated into two time periods between the end of the Cold War until 2014, which was when the U.S. backed the ousting of Viktor Yanukovych, the former Ukrainian president, and that sparked the war in the Donbass and Russia taking Crimea. But I just wanted to read what John F. Matlock Jr. had to say about the book. He was the U.S. ambassador to the Soviet Union from 1987 to 1991. He said, "It is a brilliant, remarkably concise explanation of the danger of U.S. and NATO military involvement in Ukraine, of what it has created. Needs to be read and pondered by every citizen capable of thinking rationally and responsibly about American and European security." So that is How the West Brought War to Ukraine. It's a great analysis of those events. You could buy it in the link below in the description and the show notes. It's only 10 bucks. It's a quick read, but it's packed full of good information. All right, back into the news here. The next one we got, this is from Kyle Anzalone at the Libertarian Institute. The Biden administration has announced a massive $10 billion aid package for Jordan. So this is for Jordan over the next 7 years, $10.15 billion. And it makes them the third largest recipient of U.S. aid, following only Ukraine and Israel. So the White House signed this deal on Friday, and they first discussed this new agreement on the sidelines of the Jeddah summit in July. And that's when President Biden was in Saudi Arabia, and he attended a meeting of the Gulf Cooperation Council that was also attended by Jordan. And that's apparently where this deal was worked out. And it's a huge package. And they just say how important Jordan is as an ally. What Kyle mentions here, which is interesting, is that recently, at least, the U.S., and Jordan do not see eye to eye on Syria policy. Jordan recently endorsed the Russian presence in Syria as stabilizing. You have to keep in mind, Jordan borders Syria. So when you see, you know, all of the war and fighting and foreign arms and the billions of dollars and weapons and funding that the groups like Al-Qaeda affiliated groups and stuff were getting in Syria and just what that led to. You know, when you're in the country next door, it's definitely concerning. All right. The next one here, this is, I just skipped over another one about Jordan, which the timing is very interesting. This came out on Sunday. Human Rights Watch detailed how Jordan is cracking down on dissent in the country. And they investigated 30 cases between 2019 and 2022 in which criminal defamation provisions were used to arrest and charge Jordanians expressing political opinions. It's funny because, you know, the U.S., it's Human Rights Watch, and that's an organization. The U.S. is very quick to cite if they're saying bad things about a country that the U.S. has, that the U.S. doesn't like, that the U.S. is sanctioning and stuff. But usually when it's about countries that the U.S. is supporting, like Jordan or Israel, we don't really hear that much. All right, the next one. Here, Nancy Pelosi was in Armenia over the weekend, and on Sunday, she slammed Azerbaijan for what she called illegal attacks on Armenia. So Pelosi led a congressional delegation to Armenia after these clashes erupted on the Azeri-Armenian border. That happened last week. It was the heaviest fighting in the region since the 2020 Nagorno-Karabakh War. So a ceasefire has been holding since Wednesday, but over 200 troops on both sides were killed in this flare-up. And Armenia said that the fighting was started by massive Azeri shelling, while Azerbaijan claims that it was a response, that their attack was a response to attacks on the border. And Pelosi said that it was clear that Azerbaijan was the aggressor, saying that the fighting that was initiated by the Azeris and that it needed to be recognized that they started it. She said that, quote, "We strongly condemn those attacks," end quote. Now, her comments, they break from the line, from the rhetoric that have been coming out of the Biden administration. Historically, the U.S. has leaned more towards supporting the Azeri side. And I link there to a great article about Nagorno-Karabakh from 2016 from the late Justin Raimondo. And he explains how the U.S. has been more on Azerbaijan's side. And really, Nagorno-Karabakh is an ethnic Armenian enclave that was placed within the borders of Azerbaijan. It's within their internationally recognized borders. But Justin explains here how those borders were drawn by Stalin in the Soviet Union. And it was really part of an effort to stoke this ethnic Azeri-Armenian conflict so they couldn't really form a opposition to the Soviet Union. They were more preoccupied with their own issues. And that's the borders that Nagorno-Karabakh were in. And in the war in 2020, Azerbaijan captured a lot of territory that was controlled by Armenia around Nagorno-Karabakh. But the Biden administration, I also linked to an article from Danny Serson here. He's another one who's really another expert on Nagorno-Karabakh. And he points out that Azerbaijan, a few years ago, they received a massive boost in U.S. military aid from 2016 to 2017, Azerbaijan received $3 million in U.S. military aid. In 2018 to 2019, that went up to $100 million. So that's a huge increase. And compared to Armenia in the same period, they received $4.2 million compared to Azerbaijan's $100 million. So there's a clear difference there. But the Biden administration has been taking a neutral approach to the conflict, at least publicly. That's been the line coming out of the State Department, very neutral. And Pelosi's comments in Armenia, they drew a scathing response from Azerbaijan. And they weren't happy with what she had to say. As Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi is the highest level U.S. official to visit Armenia since it became an independent state in 1991. I thought that was interesting. I had no idea. The highest level official is Nancy Pelosi. And the district that she represents is home to a large number of Armenian Americans. And the visit came ahead of the midterm elections, which will be held in November. So I've seen a few people say that they think this was more about the election than anything. And she was joined by two House members that are of Armenian descent, Representatives Anna Eshoo and Jackie Speier. They are both Democrats from California. Frank Pallone, he's a Democrat from New Jersey. He was also part of the delegation. So the next one, Iran says that it's ready to implement a prisoner swap deal with the U.S. So Iran's foreign ministry on Sunday said that it's ready to exchange, do a prisoner swap with the U.S. and that it's up to Washington to make the swap happen. Iran's foreign ministry spokesman, Nasser Kanani, said that an agreement had already been reached on the issue. He said that there's already a deal in place and it's just whether or not the U.S. wants to make the swap. And according to Iranian media, this prisoner swap deal was reached on the sidelines of the nuclear deal negotiations that were held in Vienna. Several U.S. citizens are detained in Iran, and Tehran is seeking the release of Iranians that have been arrested inside the U.S., and that's mostly for alleged sanctions violations. So the chances of the U.S. and Iran reviving the nuclear deal are unlikely, but historically, the two countries have separated the two issues. Back in 2019, they made a prisoner swap. That was during the Trump administration. That was right after the U.S. pulled out of the JCPOA and reimposed sanctions. But they were still able to do prisoner exchanges then. But now, we still haven't seen one under Biden. So that's just an example of Iran, you know, they're trying to cooperate on that issue. We'll see what happens there. But the next one, this is from Kyle Anzalone at the Libertarian Institute. The White House is making a quiet effort at closing America's infamous torture prison. So President Joe Biden has pushed behind the scenes throughout the first year of his administration to close the Guantanamo Bay torture prison. This is according to a report from the Wall Street Journal. So established in U.S.-occupied Cuba under the George W. Bush presidency, Gitmo has a cruel legacy of America carrying out barbaric interrogation methods on mostly innocent people. So it was set up in January 2002. The prison population is down to 36 from over 800 at its height. Each detainee costs American taxpayers about $15 million each year. However, many of the detainees have the U.S. government in legal limbo. If taken to court, the methods used by the CIA's torture program could become more public. Both Biden and his Democratic predecessor, Barack Obama, pledged to close Gitmo. And attempts to close the prison and transfer detainees have been met with persistent hawkish criticism. Under this pressure, Obama ultimately buckled and he actually expanded the prison. And to avoid meeting the same fate, Biden is attempting a more covert route, according to this report. But it's unclear if the Biden administration is going to make it enough of a priority to get it done, because if they want it to happen, they really have to put a lot of effort into it. And Biden's Pentagon, they're still at the same time, they're moving forward with a plan from the Trump administration to build a $4 million courtroom at Gitmo. So at the same time, they're expanding Gitmo with this courtroom project as Biden is apparently working to close it. All right. So the next one, the last one, this is from Jason Ditz. Syria has bombed the Damascus airport again, killing 5 Syrian soldiers. So this is the latest in a flurry of Israeli airstrikes in Syria. They bomb Syria all the time, but it seems like it's stepped up recently. And they've stepped up their targeting of airports, of civilian infrastructure. The Aleppo airport was bombed a few weeks ago, and the Damascus airport was bombed in July or June, and the UN said recently that because of that bombing, they couldn't deliver aid through the airport for 2 weeks. So it shows the damage that Israel's airstrikes have done. And again, they've bombed the Damascus airport, killing 5 Syrian soldiers. And they always frame these attacks on Iran as attacks on Iran, but it's often targets civilian infrastructure and kills Syrian troops, which this airstrike did, both of those things. All right, so that's it for the news. Again, we have a great piece from Ray McGovern about Putin's accusation that Ukraine has to try to attack nuclear power plants. We have a good one from Ted Snyder about U.S. accusations of Russian election interference. But that's it for the news. There's an event that I want to tell you about on October 8th. It's a Saturday in Washington, D.C. There's a rally at the Department of Justice for Julian Assange. It's from 12 p.m. to 3 p.m. So if you are in the area or if you can travel for it, you guys should come out. I'll be speaking alongside a good lineup of speakers. I'll get more information about it to fill you in. But, you know, Assange's case is the most important case when it comes to the First Amendment and free speech and journalism in our lifetime. And if he gets extradited and prosecuted, it would be such a grave implication for freedom of the press and freedom in general in this country. Our freedom depends on Assange's freedom, so it's an important issue. It's something I wish I should really kind of talk about more often, but I'll be there October 8th, 12 p.m. in D.C. I'll be reminding you about that as we go on here. But you could contact the show, news@antiwar.com. Support the show, antiwar.com/donate. Follow me on Twitter, all that good stuff. Subscribe to the YouTube. Subscribe to the Odyssey. Download where you listen to podcasts. And I'll catch you guys tomorrow with more news. Thanks for listening.